So today I'd like to talk to you about four studies we ran in an attempt towards trying to come up with a more embodied locomotion interface for virtual reality. First, I would like to thank my wonderful collaborators, Bernd Krug and Christina Tarkowski from the Hochschule Bonn-Rhein-Sieg in Germany. So they couldn't make it, so I'm trying to cover for them. And also from my own lab, Alex Kitson, so from the iSpace lab at San Francisco University and beautiful British Columbia. So after listening to the really inspiring keynote lecture yesterday by Hiroshi Ishii, I thought, well, maybe I should really start with the overall vision where we want to go there, even though I'm fully aware that we're not there yet. So the big overarching idea of what we're interested in here is really trying to come up with an interface. So it's a spatial user interface, but for self-motion, so for locomotion, that allows you to navigate through virtual environments in a more embodied way, in the sense that you really get the visceral sensation that it's really you that is moving through the environment. It's not just a camera moving through the scene. Also, that is immersive in the sense that you really feel like you're in there and moving through the environment, not just like you see something on the screen. So that is more present, that allows for spatial presence. That is effective in the sense that it allows you really to navigate, locomote, ideally as effectively and efficiently, as naturally and intuitively as in the real world, where we just have a relatively easy sense of keeping updated where we are. So even though I can move around here, I know you're here, my computer is here, my screen is here, I don't need to think about this. And we want to get to a level to that same efficiency and ease in virtual reality navigation. Elegant in the sense that we don't need these huge motion simulators or free space walking areas, which are wonderful, but just don't fit into everybody's budget or space. And affordable in the sense that they could really eventually come to everybody's place, basically. So what's the challenge with these existing wonderful interfaces? I mean, you have mouse, keyboards, joystick, and so on, and they're quite accurate, affordable, reliable, well-tested, they work, and you can replace them at low cost. So it seems like they're wonderful. I mean, one big thing they're missing is really they don't give you any physical motion signals, so no vestibular cues, and proprioceptive cues only from your hand or your fingers, typically. And same with hand gesture interfaces, your vestibular system, your lower body system isn't involved there. And what that can result in is you don't have a studio cue system, cross-modal mismatch between visual and non-visual systems, can lead to reduced spatial orientation, disorientation, maybe also motion sickness. So in a way, often enough, when you're kind of like people physically move through an environment, often enough they don't really feel like they're in there or moving through it, and they get lost and disoriented more easily. And that's one of the reasons why people came up with these wonderful large scale pre-space walking areas, which are wonderful. They allow for at least somewhat natural locomotion, interaction, and so on. But as those who work with them know, I mean, they also come still with a couple of issues, but not just in terms of space and cost, but also in terms of tracking, latency, and a bit of danger when you're tripping over with them on the display. It can be a bit tricky. Another thing that people try, obviously, are these motion simulators, where the idea is really you give people motion cueing. So when you're moving forward, you're being pressed against the seat as if you would be accelerating in a fast-moving car. So people just kind of tilt them backwards. And again, amazing setups. We tried some of them. Here's one of them, once we used it at Max Planck Institute, where I'm from originally. But in the end, they come at considerable cost complexity, and there's always a little bit of safety issues. If you have too many external actuators, you just need to really be super careful that nothing happens. So the thinking behind this talk, and actually the next one I'll present, is to see, well, can we go simpler? So can we just reduce to the bare essence? Can we really use what we know about perception, cognition, behavior to design or redesign interfaces that are cheaper and still somewhat affordable and effective? And there's lots of examples out there. Some people play around with the Wii balance board, so you're basically kind of leaning in the direction. And this works relatively well, especially if you're wearing a head-mounted display, of course, you need to make sure that people don't trip over. So there's some perceived safety concerns here about the ideas how to use this kind of surface stand. So really interesting data, lots of user studies. Other ones where you can hold on, like the Joyman, is also very interesting. Also really interesting user studies there. Most of them don't directly investigate self-motion perception the way we are interested in, so that was one of the motivations for doing what they do. another interesting study that looked at different gestures, basically, or body parts that could be used all in standing users. What we wanted to do in ours here was basically have a sitting interface, because especially when you talk to people who actually use this for a whole day, they don't really want to stand all the time. So the idea is to, just for safety, to have some kind of seated interface, yet still allow for some kind of physical motion. And there's some interesting research by Steffi Beckhaus and others using this kind of swapper motion chair. They call the GIO in the next talk on the Navi chair. That's kind of the next iteration. So I'll talk a bit more about this. But none of these explicitly really tested whether this really affects or improves self-motion perception. There's some other interfaces where there were some tests. So here's an example of the Gyroxus gaming chair, where participants here basically just lean in the direction they want to go, and then they almost magically go there. So that part works relatively well. It can actually enhance the sensation of self-motion there. But there's quite some usability issues in terms of controlling it, learnability, precision, and so on. So the idea of this user-generated motion cue works relatively well, but it's not quite there yet. And also you're sitting and having a joystick there. So we want to see, okay, well, in order to understand which part of this really works or is important, let's just kind of tease it apart and do a bit of, start with a bit of standard psychophysics. So basically, does the leading part by itself already have a benefit? And one thing we're interested in is also whether static or dynamic leading matters. So it's important that you're actually doing the motion so you get the additional distributed motion and acceleration cue, or could be enough to kind of lean forward, like sometimes you see kids doing when they're racing or imagining or when you're simulating a motorcycle. So if you look at the literature, I mean, there's not a whole lot on this, but what we found indicates that there is some effect. So if you use tilting chair and people tilt forward or backward, that actually systematically biases the perceived self-motion direction. And similarly, another paper where the tilting of the chair actually changed the horizon estimates or the elevation of objects that people were asked to judge. So we thought, well, okay, it seems like there's something promising in there, so can we go even simpler? So they still have this whole chair that you have to move. So if you take a seated observer and very little moving parts, what do you come up with? And we thought, well, okay, let's just try and see if you set people on a normal stationary chair and they just move the upper body. Seems kind of almost too simple, but we thought, well, if that alone would have an effect, that actually would be pretty neat, because we could use it. It's cheap, it's portable, doesn't cost anything. Just need to make sure that people don't have to keep this posture for too long, because that might not be the most usable thing. So the question here is, well, does this mirror upper body leaning by itself really have any useful or interesting effect? If so, why or why not, or how could we potentially use these kind of things? And things were interesting as well, does it affect how far people travel? So in this series of experiments, we asked people to do a distance production task. So we asked them to drive 10 meters, 50 meters, 20 meters, for example. We also wanted to know how they perceive the self-motion. So we asked them to rate afterwards the intensity and realism of this self-motion. Or action. And it's because we're interested also a lot into what is really going on, why do they do this. We did fairly expensive usability and user experiences questioning, afterwards observation, accident use questionnaires, and I'll combine some of that also together with the other talk. So methods are fairly simple and straightforward. So we have a participant here wearing a head-mounted display, Oculus Rift, and what they see is just a very standard limited lifetime dot optic flow display. So nothing fancy here, because we really wanted to see what the how the interface itself affects self-motion perception without any confounds of having a photorealistic view of an environment. And here, for all these four experiments here, it's actually the gamepad that controls the forward translation. It's not yet the leading. We wanted to really tease it apart and separate it. That's the paper, I guess, for next year. In order to really know how far they really leaned, so we had a simple inclination sensor in the backpack. So first study, we just looked into simple static leaning, so either 20 degrees forward, upright, or backward, different distances, different speed mappings also, so medium, fast, slow velocities, because we want to make sure that people couldn't just count seconds to produce the distance. So they had to actually do some kind of path integration. So what we found is basically, first of all, if you just plot the actual distance traveled over the instructed distance, the slope here is pretty good. We had to normalize the distance because there's absolutely no distance cues in the environment, so the absolute distance doesn't matter if you just normalize it. But the slope indicates that people are really pretty good at, if you give them a distance twice as far to move, they actually move almost twice as far. So that works relatively well, as expected. We also found that if you redo this, so in the second repetition of each condition, they actually traveled a little bit further, as if the second time around their perceived speed is a little bit reduced. Regarding the different velocities, so there was some effect of the movement velocity, so when the maximum joystick deflection resulted in faster speed, they also drove a little bit faster, but not twice as fast. So they could compensate for most of all of the differences in velocities. But one thing that was really the most interesting for us was to see, well, okay, how is the distance affected? So if people are leaning backward or upright, there's virtually no difference, but if they're leaning forward, actually they didn't travel as far, meaning it's almost as if they perceived the self-motion velocity to be faster if they're leaning forward, kind of like the racing method for you lean forward, and magically, apparently, people actually drive less far, so they seem to perceive the velocity to be larger. So that's quite interesting and promising. When we asked them about actions or self-motion perception, we did not find any clear effect. There was also a lot of noise in the data, and in retrospect, also from asking people afterwards, it really seems that one of the issues was that they had to do too many tasks at once. So they had to first get into the steady gating position, and they had to use the gate head and judge the velocities, and then also in retrospect judge the action. So that could be one reason why we have so much noise in the action data. So there's very little intervention data in these experiments here. In the second experiment, we wanted to really know, okay, what would people do if you just kind of let them explore themselves? So you tell them, well, okay, you can lean any way you like, you can stand, you can sit, you can do all kinds of funky motions, what would you actually do? So the instructions was, well, what kind of leaning motions would actually give you the most compelling sensation of self-motion? And then we just looked at it, analyzed it, rated it afterwards. And here's some of the data that we observed. So for the faster speed, people really preferred the forward-leaning motions quite a bit. They thought this was really the most effective thing that you could possibly do. Some people also like leaning backwards. That's kind of the idea that you're being pressed into the seat. And this, whereas for the normal speed or slower speed, there was some preference. Most people were just very perfectly fine being upright, so it seems like really speed matters for this one. So if you really want people to perceive a fast speed, that's when the leaning seems to really make sense. Also, if you ask them just about everybody really preferred a sitting posture, they tried standing and experimented with that, but especially with the head mounted disc, like, they didn't really like that as much. It didn't feel as safe, and they didn't feel like, oh, they would want to do this for a longer period of time. So, intermediate summary. So it seems like the leaning by itself can already enhance self-motion perception at least a little bit. And at least subjectively, it increases, affects speed as well as self-motion perception. Some of the participants in this exploratory experiment also experimented with dynamic leaning and all kinds of things they could think of. And those who did actually claimed that it really helped, so it enhanced the self-motion perception. So that's one of the motivations for the next two experiments to really look into dynamic leaning. So where people really do this kind of, it's almost like a human joystick. So the idea is very much the same. Still in this one, we let people control the self-motion with a gamepad just to have comparability and at the same time lean forward and backward. The rest was pretty same plot here, so they were fairly good overall. There's not too much compression of the distances traveled. What we found this time also was that the faster speed resulted in more intense action, so the faster they drove, the more stronger the sensation was, but distances traveled wasn't affected by speed. Now the surprising part was that there was really no main effect of the leaning on the distance traveled or action. So no main effect there. And that kind of surprised us given what we found in the experiment 1 and 2. So we thought, okay, what was going on? It was one kind of slightly strange interaction in that leaning affected how speed affected self-motion. little bit tricky, so I'll try to explain. So basically, when you're leaning forward or backwards, faster speeds really lead to a more realistic sensation of center of motion. It seems like there's something different when you lean versus if you don't lean. But it's not a huge effect size. So then if I go for the fourth experiment, well, how about the amount of leaning? So here we were just leaning just a little bit, so 10 degrees forward and backwards. What happens if you lean further or less far? So in the fourth one, we just had a couple of different leaning angles between minus 30 and plus 30 degrees, and wanted to see, okay, what happens now? The interesting thing is nothing happens. And so no significant effects of leaning of action intensity or realism. And then if you look at the distances, we actually observe the opposite of what we expected. So, well, that's in reality a perception research. So actually, leaning increased the distances that people travel, and we thought, well, that doesn't make any sense. So we looked more into the exit interviews and kind of what people did and how they interpreted. So we asked them about strategies and so on. And what turned out actually was that it's almost like they did a two-stage processing. So here's what we had in the first experiment, here's kind of the opposite effect. So it almost seems like when they had to do this active leaning, they did a two-stage process. They started going forward and leaning forward, but they did only really started counting distance or assessing distance once they were in the right position, and then they got back. So basically, there's this additional time they needed to lean. So it almost seems like they did things sequentially because we gave them too many things to do at once. So having to do the action rating and the distance and the leaning at the same time, that just might have taken them off, so they get just kind of linearized in their mind. So that's exactly not what you really want, but well, it's interesting. I mean, you can still learn quite a bit from this. Now, interestingly, if you ask them afterwards in the exit interview, most of them, 75%, said that the leaning really did have an effect. So there's some discrepancy, and most of them preferred the kind of medium range leaning, so 15 degrees or so, not 30, that was too much, and 5 was maybe not enough. And most of them preferred the forward leaning for forward self-motion, not the other one. A bit more usability measures, so if you ask them about the overall confidence, it's relatively high. There's a few people out there, so we need to look more at kind of what is actually the issue here. Partially, it's probably they have not displayed from what we observed. In terms of relaxation, the being upright obviously is a little bit better, but leaning forward and backward actually wasn't so bad. Again, there's a few people that were not super happy with it, so we need to look into more detail there. But overall, the posture was rated as not being an issue. So that's promising. So in concluding, so we did see that static leaning can really reduce the distance traveled, and so it seems like it might actually enhance the speed perception. Although, note that we did not explicitly investigate speed just. We didn't ask about the speed, because people have a harder time judging that about previous instances. Of course, this is not suitable for like 2 hour travel. You don't want to lean forward that much, but for the shorter periods of time, it could be interesting. It could be an interesting thing to just enhance things. The dynamic training that showed fairly unexpected results, and part of that could be due to the dual triple task issue that we had here. So that's why in experiment 3 we did not find the effect, and experiment 4 there was kind of the opposite. But definitely there's a lot more research needed here. Action itself also wasn't affected here. Again, this could also be part of the issue with the dual task, and also that they have to actively look around. In most of action research is passive, it's just kind of you're watching medium and then you read yourself, so you have more time and cognitive resources left to really look for your gut feeling of am I moving or not. However, when you ask people afterwards, just what everybody says that this leading really does help, so it seems like there's something interesting in it, and people prefer it especially for the faster set of motions. Same thing there, especially for the dynamic leaning, it's pretty obvious. So it seems like this simple leaning doesn't solve the whole trick. It can be part of the puzzle. It could be used to enhance the self-motion interfaces, but by itself is clearly not enough, at least not in the way we did it here. So there's clearly some changes needed in the tasks we did and so on. By the way, this also shows how important it was, at least for us, to do all these extensive exit interviews and questionnaires afterwards, because otherwise we would not know how to interpret the data, and still there's lots of questions. But at least we know how to move on. I'll go into this a bit more in terms of design guidelines. So I'll basically summarize them from both papers and the second one. What I'd like to mention is, so the idea of this human joystick is something we're kind of exploring right now, where basically the inclination sensor that we placed on the back will directly, just like a joystick, control where you're going and how far, by using something like this water chair or another one that has a bit more movement abilities. And a bit of a sneak preview, so you tried some of this already, so comparing a gamepad and a joystick. And one of the interesting things you notice right away is when you just look at the mean velocity for different distances they had to travel, for the gamepad, many people just kind of maxed it out like with full speed. Both with the human joystick, they have much more sensitivity, so they're more gradual in how far and how fast they wanted to go. Right, so that's the intermediate stop here, and thanks, of course, for all the different funding agencies. So I guess we could do a